Hi folks, this is Joe, and this video is about patinating metal leaf on turned objects. I first learned about this process by watching that TV show Rough Cut, where David Marks demonstrated the technique. I realized pretty quickly that it's a very easy process to do. It doesn't take a whole lot of materials. It takes a bit of time, only because you're waiting for certain things to dry, but the whole process is relatively quick and easy, and it shows a good opportunity, I think, to be creative. Now, the couple objects I'm going to show you now that I did aren't all that creative. It was more of the experimental thing, but I've got some ideas to perhaps expand upon that. This first object is the first thing I turned, or patinated, I mean, and it was, or is, red oak. It was very indistinct in its green pattern, and I thought, well, what the heck, let me give it a try. Now, you'll notice that the primary background color in this is blue, and the patinated metal on this is silver. I since went out and bought some copper, and you'll see that on the next piece. And what I did was, first I covered it with blue paint, then I cut it back a little bit with some sandpaper to bring out in some places some of the wood. Then I applied the patinated metal and then patinated it. And this is what I came up with. Now the second one I did, I used two colors as background or base color. The first color was again blue, but the second color was red. And what I did was I cut back with sandpaper the red so that some of the blue would come out. And then this time I used gold leaf, copper leaf, and silver leaf. Now you'll see here, that's a little bit of gold leaf. I don't know if it shows up on the screen, but that little bit is gold leaf, and you'll see that it didn't really patinate at all. And that's the nature of gold. This is silver here, and then this is copper. The copper turns very, very dark. The silver gets a mottled brown, but there's graduations in the degree of patination, and it made it look kind of interesting. The other thing I did, if you'll notice, is after I applied the leaf, I then took the chopstick, actually, and scraped away some of the leaf, so I got these little bit of lines in there and stuff like that. There's a lot of other things I think you can do to be kind of creative with all this. Nick Agar sells templates for primarily for airbrushing on the work he does. You know, things like butterflies and maple leaves and stars and things like that. And although he uses them in an outline form, I think that one could patinate, you know, use such templates to outline a shape so that the shape itself is an unpatinated metal and the surrounding area is patinated, or you could do actually the reverse patinate the area where the object is and then leave the area surrounding it clean. One could also use masking tape to make geometric designs. You know, and then you paint it up through the Japan paint, and then you could remove that so some of the real wood would come through. I think there's a whole lot of ways to play around with it. Not that I've done a whole lot of them, but it's got my brain turning a bit, and I think it's something that if when you see some of these basic ways to go about doing it, you can let your imagination go a little bit wild and do something that's creative and maybe looks good. Okay, these are the basic materials you need in order to do some patination. These two at the bottom, made by CraftSmart, I picked up at AC Moore or Michaels, I don't remember which, but the ones that I use almost exclusively or from Amazon and by a company called Barnabas. They sell various metal leaf. I have packets here of copper leaf, gold, and silver. Now, in order to attach the leaf to the turned object, you need some sort of an adhesive or sizing. And they sell sizing at art stores like Blix and stuff, but I use basically spar varnish. I apply it, let it harden to the point, or dry to the point where it gets a bit tacky, and then stick the leaf to it, wait for everything to dry and harden up, and then move on from there. I think the sizing probably dries much more quickly than the spar varnish ever would, but, you know, I'm usually not in a hurry to get something done. I sort of enjoy the whole process. Now, the background paints I use, again, come from that video that I saw of David Marks on Rough Cut. It's super fine Japan colors purchased through Amazon, and I've got both a permanent blue color and a Liberty Red color. These are a little bit expensive. I don't remember the relative cost, but they dry remarkably fast. When I bought these, I also bought some Japan dryer, but I didn't bother using it because the paint set up and dried so quickly, I found no real use. Now, I've used over time a lot of different patinating chemicals, most of which I made myself. I've used bat guano, I've used rotten eggs, I used urine from my dog, and a couple other things. And they were great fun, you know, this chemical exploration. And they did an okay job, but they weren't really impressive. So I took the plunge and I bought some liver of sulfur. This, I believe, too, I got from Amazon. It's made by a company called Eurotool. It runs about $8 and you get 4 ounces. I also have used in the past potassium sulfate, but that takes a little bit of mixing and a little bit of time. And I found that just using the liver sulfur, it moves much more quickly. Now, in order to apply the liver sulfur or the potassium sulfate, of course, you've got to dissolve it in water, or in the case of the liver sulfur, mix it with hot water. And so I just put stuff in a jar, heat it up, and then apply it. You don't have to buy Spanish green olives. You can use any jar you want. Now, in order to cease the patinating process, you need to neutralize it. And neutralization is simply baking soda and water, and it's nice and easy. I've also got some cheesecloth. The cheesecloth is what put that little hash pattern onto the object. You can see like the hash pattern there. And then of course, you need some measuring spoons. And I found that you really need stainless steel measuring spoons because the liver of sulfur does a real job on anything other than stainless steel. Well, that's about it for all that you need in order to get started, aside from a turned piece of wood. So we're going to go off and do that next. Okay, so here's what I'm going to do. I took this Norway maple bowl and randomly placed some green masking tape on the inside of the bowl, and I'm going to use that to shield some of the wood as I put the Japan paint on. I may put on one layer of Japan paint and then add more masking tape. I'm not quite sure, but we'll see what happens. What the heck. So what I'm going to do is now just paint a layer of Japan paint and then restart the video after it's dried and when I'm deciding whether or not to add any more masking tape to it. Okay, so now the bowl has been painted with the Japan paint with the blue color. You can see a little bit of the masking tape sticking out through it. I figured there's no sense covering all the masking tape. And what I'll do next is after this dries, I'll put a coat of the red Japan paint on it, and when that hardens, then I'll continue the video as I'm sanding and cutting back the red to bring up some of the blue to the surface, and then I'll also remove the masking tape and we'll see whether that was a good idea or not. All right. Okay, now here's the bowl. I had the had applied the blue paint, then the red paint, cut it back with sandpaper, and then removed the painter's tape that I had applied. I'm not quite sure how all this is going to turn out, but we'll move on to the next step, being that I'll coat it with the spar varnish, let it sit a while until it gets tacky, then we'll apply the metal leaf, and then wait for the spar varnish to harden, and then patinate it and see what we come up with. Okay, I've let the spar varnish set up for a while, so it's still tacky, but not soaking wet. I'm gonna apply some copper leaf and some silver leaf. This is the copper leaf. I'm just taking off a piece. Probably won't use the whole thing. I'm going to randomly place it down. I'm going to rip that away. We'll leave that there. That's not bad. Take another piece. Maybe drape it up here. And a little piece of silver, a little piece of copper here, maybe. And that's about it. We move over to the silver. I use basically the equivalent of a tongue depressor to lift the leaf off the paper, make it a little bit more manageable. Nope, it's not coming off. But one thing you don't have to worry about is overlapping pieces, because as I'll be able to show you in a few minutes, you can, if there's no spar varnish holding it down, then it doesn't stick and you're going to be able to remove it, brush it away. Similar for when, if you were to overlap two pieces, only the piece that's touching the spar varnish is going to stick, and the overlapping piece you're able to brush away. This is not coming off easily at all. I'm getting little pieces. Fighting with me. Okay, here's a good sized piece coming along. And we'll put that here. And we'll take this. Come on. I don't know, it could be that this stuff is kind of old and maybe a year old and it's not coming off the paper as easily as one would hope. See how it's doubled over? I just lift it off, put it down. Okay. Maybe a little more, get somewhat of an equal amount of silver with an equal amount of copper on the surface. Ah, put that there, there. Take this. Whoa, just not cooperating. And I think this is all being recorded and it's not cooperating like I wanted to. Well, I can't do a second take of this. It is what it is. Okay. So, here we have the copper and the silver. And what you do then is you take a piece of wax paper. And you place the wax paper on top of the piece of the foil. Then you take a paper towel and you rub it on, and it flattens out and it sticks. Flip this over, since I exposed it to some of the varnish, I don't want it to pull it off. So here, just rubbing it in, getting rid of all the wrinkles. Yeah, not all the wrinkles, but probably enough of them. Go around and do this piece. Luckily, with this COVID-19 stuff going on, nobody's in a rush to buy wax paper. Flatten it all down. Here's another piece. Flatten it down. Stick it in good. Here's this other piece. Flatten that down. Pieces. Now, wherever there's an overlap, wherever you have basically crumbs, you don't want to try to brush them away or anything until the spar varnish has hardened completely. Because if you do it too soon, all those little crumbs or whatnot will just simply move or migrate from where you're brushing it and just stick somewhere else. And unless you want that to happen, you gotta wait for it to harden. And there's a piece over here I didn't quite get. And then this piece around the edge. Rub that in at the corner. Okay, now it's not been cleaned up with a brush or anything, but here we are thus far. I don't like this. There we go. So we'll just wait for all this to set up, and then we'll do the patination. So that's it for this segment. Okay, so here we are outside. Going to drape the cheesecloth over this thing to give it the patination some sort of texture. Now, the astute observers amongst you will notice something different. And what's different here is this is a whole different bowl. And why it's different is because this is a second take. The first take didn't turn out, folks, and I wasn't going to show you if it didn't turn out. So I went about and started the whole not the whole process, but the Japan paint and cutting it back. Oh, that's our neighboring what do you call it? Peacock. He's still looking for a mate, but he isn't going to find one. Okay, things are patinaing up quickly in places. Boom! You ought to see these colors explode in some places. See if we can see it on this copper here. See what's happening. One. Now look at that white right there. Boom, here it goes, see? Look at that. Okay, we're getting some of the silver done. I'm running this about 15 degrees lower temperature than I've done in the past. I'm doing this, I started at about 125 degrees as opposed to 140, because I wanted it to react a little bit more slowly. Okay, it's coming along. Oh, there's a piece there. I don't think I need to patinate every piece. Let's see how the silver's doing. Yeah, silver's going to take a little while. Brush that through. This is like a quadruple layer here of cheesecloth. Let's put some directly on it. See what happens there. Yeah. Just playing around. Another reason to do it outside is because the sunlight tends to accelerate the patination. Now, I don't like, some of it's getting too dark, the copper's getting too dark. So in those spot areas, using my baking soda solution, I'm going to stop the process by neutralizing it. Just don't want the copper to get any darker. It's pretty damn dark. We'll let it continue to go a few minutes longer on the silver. And we'll see how it looks. Phew, this stinks. My dog just couldn't stop sneezing in the shop. She didn't like it at all. Okay, time for the great reveal. Let's see what we got. Whoa. Okay, let's neutralize the whole thing. So we've got stuff that's bordering on black here. Nice brown. And then what we'll do is we'll dry it, then we'll let it dry. Then I'll put some coats of probably like a spray lacquer on it. Okay. Now, let's see. Okay, you'll see some of it's really dark. You can see hash marks and different colors. And there you can see a whole variety of different textures and stuff. All right, I think that'll do. Oh, this was an old piece of sassafras. Been trying to sell it for years. No one would buy it because it was ugly.
That's almost the end of this video. I'm sort of reluctant to show you the finished product because it's kind of ugly. Why, you may ask, is it ugly? Well, it's ugly because I got the proportions all wrong. Notice on this piece that there's just about an equal amount of metal leaf that's been patinated with the background color. Whereas the one I did today, there's a whole lot more blue and there's very little metal leaf. The proportions are completely off. In the vase I showed at the beginning of the video, there's even a greater proportion of metal leaf to background wood, and that's also pleasing, but it's sort of like the exact opposite of this. This is far too extreme, nowhere near enough metal leaf on this. And the more I look at this one, the more I like this one, and I never liked this one that much either. So, a couple things. One, the temperature of the water with a liver of sulfur in it is partly determines how long it takes to patinate the metal. The higher the temperature, the quicker it patinates. I've used it at 140 degrees for the first two pieces. For subsequent pieces, I've been using it at about 125 degrees. And by the time, you know, you get it outside to where you're going to actually apply it, it's probably lost another 5-7 degrees. That gives you a little bit more control. Also, sunlight has an effect on the speed with which things patinate. I've tried it on cloudy days, and it works good and you're under control, but if you're in direct sunlight, it happens very, very quickly. So there are a couple of the lessons learned by me for doing this. Primarily has to do with the proportion of the metal leaf to the background color. I think if there's going to be any questions, I'll probably be able to answer them on Zoom. Thanks a lot for tolerating this. I hope the hell it turns out okay. I had a lot of fun making this, but Steven Spielberg has absolutely nothing to worry about. I don't think it'll be too hard for any of you to outdo what I did. So give it a try. And hopefully when all this COVID crap is done, I'll get to see you all again soon. Take care. Bye-bye.